the sun to shine above. He cares about the moon that shines at night. He cares about the way we live our lives. He cares about the way we treat each other.
Psalm 63 says, "Oh God, you are my God. Early will I seek your face. My soul, it thirsts for you." How many have a thirsting for the Holy Ghost? How many have a longing in your spirit? Oh God.
Good morning, Clive. Good morning, Pastor. How are you today?
I am well.
Good morning, Good Shepherd. Good morning, Good Shepherd, church family. Great is your mercy towards me, your loving kindness towards me, your tender mercies I see day after day, forever faithful towards me, always providing for me. Great is your mercy towards me. Great is your grace. Great is your mercy towards me, your loving kindness towards me, your tender mercies I see day after day, forever faithful towards me, always providing for me. Great is your mercy towards me. Great is your grace. Great is your mercy towards me. Your loving kindness towards me. Your tender mercy.
Amen. Thank you, Clive. Good morning, Good Shepherd family, and welcome to worship on this first Sunday of Lent. As we begin our journey into the 40 days and 40 nights, I pray that this service will provide you some comfort and some sustenance and some empowerment for the journey that is before us. The Holy Spirit calls us together as the people of God. This past week on Ash Wednesday, as a community, we began our journey towards baptismal immersion in the death and the resurrection of Christ. This year, the Sundays in Lent lead us to focus on five covenants God makes in the Hebrew scriptures, and to use those covenants as the lenses through which we view our own baptism. First Peter today, which we'll hear, connects the way God saved Noah's family in the flood with the way God saves us through the waters of our own baptisms. The baptismal covenant is made with us, each of us individually, but the new life that we are given in baptism is not just for us, it is for the sake of the whole world. Let us begin our worship with our call to worship. The bags are packed and set for the journey. Are you ready? Not really. We have so much still to do. The Lord calls us now. The peace of God is at hand. What will be required of us for this journey? Open your hearts and your spirits. Take the risk of discipleship. Lord, help us to be ready. Calm our fears as we step forward in faith. And God's people said, Amen. We will continue with our order for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God whose forgiveness is sure and whose steadfast love endures forever. And God's people said, Amen. Together, let us honestly and humbly confess that we have not lived as God desires. God of the rainbow, you made a covenant with all your creatures, promising life and hope. God of pathways, you show us how we should walk, yet we forget our connection with one another and think that we are the center of the universe. We wander from your paths of truth into paths of deceit and pride. Forgive us and lead us back into the arms of your love. Amen. Beloved of God, my sisters and brothers, God is merciful and full of steadfast love. God will not forget us. God will wash us clean and lead us on paths of steadfast love and faithfulness. And God's people said, Amen.
Let us pray. Faithful God, you called all creatures into being, and you care for each one of them. Send your grace upon your people gathered here, that we may follow your ways of truth and walk in the paths of steadfast love, proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, my church family and friends who are worshiping with us this morning. And for welcome and for our announcement, our announcement is as follows. We want to continue offering a Black History Moment once each month. The presentation can be about a person or an event. Please contact Pastor Linda by email or by phone if you're willing to offer a presentation. Even if you don't have an idea for a topic, Pastor will be happy to assist you with that. On March the 7th is the date of our annual congregational meeting. The meeting will take place immediately after worship. Please plan to be in attendance as we discuss and conduct the business of being church together. And if you shop on Amazon.com, you can support our church. We can support our church with all of our purchases by using the Amazon Smile. A portion of each purchase is donated to our church. You can use the link attached here for all your purchases and help our church. And the link is just below the announcement. The calendar of events on Sunday, February, on Tuesday, February the 23rd, 2021 at 6:30 is a council meeting. Immediately after this morning's worship, we'll have the virtual Sunday school on Zoom. And on Wednesday, February the 24th, we will have the Lenten study at 7 p.m. And on Thursday, February the 25th, at 7 p.m., there's a confirmation class for grades 8 through high school. And that concludes my events for the coming week. And Pastor, over to you if you have anything in addition to add to this.
Thank you, Yvonne. I do have a couple of things. One is I have learned from some other pastors in our area that there is a scam that is going around where people are receiving phone calls and emails asking them to donate gift cards on behalf of the church. If we are doing anything like that, believe me, you will hear about it in worship, or you will hear about it in an email that comes from myself or from Good Shepherd. So if you receive any phone call or email soliciting anything like that, it certainly is not coming from us. So just be aware. It has happened at about 5 churches in our area. Wow. So just beware. The other thing I would ask is that if you are at all familiar with running a Zoom meeting, we are still in need of a backup person for our confirmation and Christian formation class for our young people. So, and it's not scary at all. It's really quite easy and laid out. So if you have the ability to run a Zoom meeting, I would like for you to contact me and maybe I can help you be the backup person for our Thursday evening classes. And finally, I would ask, as I did for Advent and Christmas, that if you have any hymns that are your favorites for this holy season of Lent, Holy Week, or Easter, please text them to me, call me with them, or email them to me so that we can compile a list of music that the congregation would like to hear during this holy season. Thank you so much. And now we will continue our worship as we hear the word that God has for us today. Oh no, sorry. I got ahead of myself. We will now have our Black History moment. Today, our presenter is Joan Porter.
Good morning, church family. Today, I present to you Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth. Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth once called the most courageous civil rights fighter by none other than Dr. Martin Luther King. Fred Shuttlesworth was a major leader in the civil rights movement for greater than 50 years. He was called to pastor the Bethel Baptist Church in Birmingham, Alabama in 1953 and became very active in the work of the NAACP. In May of 1956, he founded the Alabama Christian Movement for Human Rights, also known as ACMHR, after the NAACP was banned from activity in the state of Alabama by the Alabama Circuit Court. With well-attended weekly meetings, he sought to integrate Birmingham in every respect, and this angered local law enforcement. In December 1956, after bus segregation was ruled illegal in Montgomery, Alabama, Shuttlesworth announced that the ACMHR was going to test segregation laws in Birmingham. On Christmas night, the night before the planned action was to begin, a bomb exploded under the parsonage of the church. Reverend Shuttlesworth was unharmed and the church was destroyed. He was undeterred by the bombing. The following day, he led several hundred protesters who showed up in the whites-only sections of Birmingham buses. The ACMHR then successfully filed suit in federal court that ended local laws mandating bus segregation in Birmingham. But his activism, however, did not end there. Reverend Shuttlesworth, Dr. King, and Reverend Ralph Abernathy became co-founders of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference in 1957, dedicated to the use of nonviolent methods to combat segregationist laws. Shuttlesworth continuously urged the organization to aggressively confront segregation. He said in a letter to Dr. King in 1959, and I quote, "I feel that the leadership in Alabama among the Negroes is at this time much less dynamic and imaginative than it ought to be. I believe we must move now or else be hard put in the not too distant future to justify our existence," end quote. This led to Dr. King later answering a call by Shuttlesworth to join the forces of the ACMHR and SCLC 1963 to help lead a series of demonstrations called the Birmingham Campaign. Project C was born out of the Birmingham Campaign. C, please note, is for confrontation. Shuttlesworth and SCLC made the controversial decision to use teenagers and school children in the Project C demonstrations. It later became known as the Children's Crusade. Attack dogs and firefighter hoses were turned on the protesters, which caused a national outcry and the eventual breakdown of the city's racist policies. Although some within the civil rights movement criticized his actions and the use of antagonism to achieve his goals, the protests and the resulting police brutality of the Birmingham campaign created a new level of visibility for the civil rights movement. This visibility contributed to the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, introduced to Congress by then President John F. Kennedy. On the day he introduced the bill, the president remarked, But for Birmingham, we would not be here today. Though they were closer together for many years, Shuttlesworth and King made a very unlikely pair. Shuttlesworth was outspoken, temperamental, and willing to use conflict to further the goals of a civil rights movement. King was deemed too cautious and too conciliatory. Shuttlesworth's confrontational style served as a counterbalance to King's more measured approach and served to inspire people to action. In his memoir of the Birmingham campaign, King praised Shuttlesworth, and I quote, "The fiery words and determined zeal of Fred Shuttlesworth proved to his people that he would not ask anyone to go where he was not willing to go," end quote. He was jailed dozens of times, survived 3 attempts on his life, and survived a brutal beating at the hands of the KKK when he attempted to enroll his daughters in a segregated school. Reverend Shuttlesworth was honored in 2008 when the Birmingham Airport Authority renamed the city's airport in his honor as the Birmingham Shuttlesworth International Airport. He passed away in 2011, but today the struggle continues. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Joan. Reverend Shuttlesworth is certainly someone who we should all know about. He was a champion in the civil rights movement. Now, our worship will continue as we hear the word that God has for us today. God speaks to us in scripture reading, preaching, and through song. Please join me as we bless our lector for today. Let us pray. Gracious God, bless Tom, our lector, as we turn to your word for us. May the Spirit of God rest upon us. Help us to be steadfast in our hearing, in our speaking, in our believing, and in our living. Amen.
Today's first reading is from Genesis chapter 9. Today's reading is the conclusion to the flood story. Because of human sin, God destroys the earth by flood, saving only Noah, his family, and the animals on the ark. Yet divine destruction gives way to divine commitment. As in the first creation, God blesses humanity and establishes a covenant with all creatures. The reading. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as come out of the ark. I will establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Our psalm for today is Psalm 25, verses 1 through 10. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. My God, I put my trust in you. Let me not be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. Let none who look to you be put to shame. Rather, let those be put to shame who are treacherous. Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. In you have I trusted all the day long. Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting. Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your steadfast love for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. You are gracious and upright, O Lord. Therefore, you teach sinners in your way. You lead the lowly in justice and teach the lowly your way. All your paths, O Lord, are steadfast love and faithfulness to those who keep your covenant and your testimonies. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. Today's second reading is from 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 18 through 22. As God acted through Christ's suffering and death to bring us to God, so God acts through baptism to save us from a sinful existence. This spiritual cleansing marks our new life in Christ. The reading. Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey when God patiently waited in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, 8 persons were saved through water. And baptism, which is prefigured, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Beloved of God, I invite you now to listen to the Holy Gospel according to Mark, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days. Tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." This, beloved, is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Amen. Thank you so much, Dana. So here we are, the first Sunday of Lent. And this journey always brings a lot to my mind as I think back over all of the Lents of my life, whether they were actually in the Lenten season or not. And this week, as I meditated on the text for this week, and there's a lot of water in the text and talk about baptism, and that certainly was a way to go, but there were other things that actually stood out for me, and I'd like to share my thoughts with you this morning. I believe that it was when I was a little girl in Sunday school when I first heard the story of Jesus being tempted in the wilderness. And I remember my Sunday school teacher then, she was this grandmotherly kind of woman, at least the kind that we thought of being grandmotherly in that day. Her hair was always in a hairnet. And on the board at the front of our room where we had Sunday school, there was a map of the Judean wilderness stretched across the board. On the far left of that landscape was an innocuous looking devil figure, red suited and fork-tailed, and that figure was stooped in the sand, reaching for a loaf-shaped stone. And to the right of that figure was a supremely undisturbed white Jesus. And that Jesus towered over the entire landscape in a pristine white robe, and his finger was pointed at that tempter. Now, to be fair to my Sunday school teacher, I'm sure she was doing the best that she could to ease us very young, tender hearts into a story that might have frightened us. So I do give her credit for that. But there was a big problem with that, at least there was for me, because what I absorbed from her and from that Sunday morning, and maybe from many other Sunday mornings too when I was young, was this superhero version of Jesus. And that version left no room for his humanity. Not to mention that that Jesus didn't even look anything like the way he was described in the Bible. But that's a sermon for another day. At no point in my childhood or my young adulthood even did it occur to me that Jesus actually struggled in the wilderness. It didn't occur to me that Jesus could hurt, that he hungered, that he wept, that he thirsted, that he wrestled, and that he suffered. Instead, I assumed that his triumph over evil, that was a foregone conclusion, and that trial never cost Jesus anything. Well, it took me a really long time to shed that image of the Jesus from my childhood. But I have to be honest and say that there are times, even now, that I long for that Jesus. I long for his divinity, the certainty of it, the mighty and magical promise of it. To overwhelm his humanity, I long for that so that he can be this bright and reassuring hero in my life. But beloved, I say to you today, Lent is not a season for unshakable heroes. Superheroes. It's a season for vulnerable creatures whose wilderness journeys are never easy and they are never straightforward. Lent is a season of shadow, a season when our uncertainties go into the fire and burn down to ashes. It's a season of vulnerability, of honesty, of humility and penitence. So with all of that said, to read the wilderness story of Jesus as a story of simplistic triumph, well, that for me at least misses the whole point. And why do I say that? Well, I say it because I believe that we need a Jesus of the desert. We need to know that Jesus wrestled with real demons and real dangers during those 40 days and 40 nights of temptation. And as alluring as it may be to cling to a divine superhero, I believe that we need the Jesus who endured a terrain where the Holy Spirit, the diabolical one, the wild beasts, and the angels all resided together. Alone, beloved, we will never survive such a dangerous place. And Jesus did not survive alone. But with a companion who knows the way, well, then we can make it. So unlike his counterparts in gospel writing, Matthew and Luke, Mark offers us no colorful details about the experience that Jesus has in the wilderness. We don't learn what the diabolical one's specific temptations are or were. We don't know how Jesus responded to them. All Mark gives us are a few short sentences. The Spirit immediately drove Jesus out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness for 40 days, tempted by Satan. He was with the beasts, and the angels waited on him. So as I reflect on just this version of the story, there are some details that stand out for me. The first one is that Jesus did not choose to go into the wilderness. He didn't schedule an expedition there. He didn't plan to be this desert marathon. The Spirit of God drove him there, compelled him, forced him into the desolation of a wild and unsafe place. Jesus did not want to go. And in my holy imagination, it's very possible that he even resisted. But the Spirit drove him there anyway. Now, maybe it's strange that I find that detail comforting, but I do. And I do so because it rings so true to life. Beloved, most of the time, we don't choose to enter any of the wildernesses that come into our lives. We don't volunteer or sign up for pain or loss or danger or terror. But the wilderness, it happens anyway. Whether it comes to us in the guise of a devastating pandemic, a frightening hospital stay, a broken relationship, a hurting child, a loss of faith, the wilderness appears, and sometimes I believe it is God's very Spirit that drives us there. Now, don't get me wrong. This does not mean that God wills or wants bad things to happen to us. I do not believe that. Does it mean that God is ready to teach and shape and redeem us even during the most harsh periods of our lives? Well, yes, I do believe that. You've heard me talk about the economy of God before, and in the shocking and sometimes frightening economy of God, even a dangerous desert can become a very holy place. So I say that even our wilderness wanderings can reveal the divine. This is not because God takes pleasure in our pain, but because we live in a chaotic, fragile, and broken world, a world that includes deserts. And because God's modus operandi is to take the things of shadow and death and bring resurrection from them, the wilderness can be very holy. Another thing I notice is that our wilderness journeys sometimes last a very, very long time. Now, I've never spent 40 days in total solitude and silence, much less in a state of physical deprivation and danger. But I can't imagine that the time that Jesus spent in the wilderness, I can't imagine that that time passed quickly for him. The sense that I get from Mark's gospel is that Jesus despaired of that grim place, that he experienced each day as a battle of the mind, the spirit, and the body. Maybe the hours stretched into years. Maybe the nights felt as if they were endless. For those of us who live in this impatient and quick fix culture, this aspect of the wilderness is probably quite daunting, because so many of us, we tire and despair so quickly. Why, we ask, why is this pain not ending? Why are our prayers going unanswered? Where is God? But I say to you, beloved, maybe there's another question we should be asking. Maybe we should be asking, why did Jesus need the wilderness? Maybe we should be asking, why do we need the wilderness? See, Mark's story begins with the account of Jesus's baptism. And when Jesus arose out of the waters of the Jordan River, the heavens tore open and God announced, "You are my son, the beloved. With you, I am well pleased." But what happened to that certain sense of identity and belonging in the wilderness wanderings of Jesus? I wonder that as those wanderings stretched into a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, did that waver? Did that sense of who Jesus was, did that waver? Did the Son of God have to keep reminding himself who he was? Did he have times, days, hours, weeks, when he actually forgot? You see, beloved, at his baptism, Jesus heard the absolute truth about who he was. That was the easy part. The much harder part came in the desert when he had to face down that vicious, mocking assault on the truth that he knew. As the memory of God's voice faded and the isolation of the wilderness started to play tricks on his heart and his mind, he had to learn that his belovedness would hold through everything. He had to learn that God's deep and unconditional delight would never, never depend on external circumstances. So if those 40 days in the wilderness was a time of self-creation or recreation for Jesus, a time for Jesus to decide who he was and how he was going to live out his calling, then I know from that time that Jesus chose deprivation over power. Jesus chose vulnerability over rescue. Jesus chose obscurity over honor. And at every instance in which he could have reached for the certain, the extraordinary, the miraculous even, instead, Jesus reached for the quiet and the mundane. Now, of course, there's nothing easy about affirming these choices of Jesus. But indeed, I find them kind of appalling, really, because how often do I prefer the miraculous intervention? How often would I prefer the dramatic rescue? How often do I prefer the long-awaited vindication? How often do I find myself echoing the demands of the tempter? Feed me, deliver me, prove who you are. How often do I find the restraint of God really offensive to me? You might feel the same way. Beloved, sometimes we, like Jesus, we need a long stint in the wilderness. We need it in order to learn what it really means to be God's beloved. Because the unnerving truth is that we can be loved and we can be uncomfortable simultaneously. We can be loved and we can be vulnerable at the same time. And in the wilderness, the love that survives, that love is relentless. That love is salvific. That love is not sentimental. But learning to trust in that love, well, that takes time, beloved. It takes a long time. It takes a lifetime. So I want to tell you one last thing that stands out for me. And that is, there were angels there. And I had to look at the Greek for this because I kind of remembered from my seminary days that angels was not really what the Greek word meant. So it's really messengers. If you translate the Greek literally, there were messengers in the wilderness for Jesus. So even in the land of shadow and starvation, even in a place where the wild beasts were roaming, God's agents, God's messengers of love and care, they were there. Now, this too is really surprising and comforting. It's a surprising and comforting truth for me. And it should be for you too, one that we can recognize if we open our eyes and take a good look around us. Because even in the ugliest and the worst places, God abides. And somehow, without any reason or explanation, help comes. Rest comes. Solace comes. Now, granted, our angels, our messengers, they don't always appear in the forms that we are looking for. But I can guarantee you that they come. So as I wandered this week, I wondered, what did the messengers or the angels look like who came for Jesus? Were they manifested as winged creatures from heaven? Or were they just simply comforting breezes that blew across the sun-scorched hills? Were they a trickle of water that parched the trickles of water that soothed Jesus's parched throat? Were the angels a constellation in the sky on a very clear, cloudless night? Beloved, what do your angels and your messengers look like? Do you recognize them when they show up? Do you recognize them when they minister to you, when they hold you, when they prop you up, do you hear them? Do you hear God's voice through them? Hear God's voice calling you beloved? And if you do, then what would it be like for you to enter someone else's barren desert right now? What would it be like for you to become an angel and a messenger for someone who's on their wilderness journey? Beloved, as we begin our journey into Lent together, I pray that we may experience the companionship of the Christ whose vulnerability became his strength. May we enter with courage the deserts that we can't choose and we really can't avoid them. May our long stints amidst the wild beasts teach us who we really are, that we are the precious and beautiful children of God. And when the angels and the messengers in all their sweet and secret guises whisper to us that we are beloved, may we listen to them. But not only listen, may we believe them. Amen. Thank you so much, Jessica and Clive. Our worship will continue as we use the words of the Apostles' Creed to profess our faith. I believe in God, the Father, Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Amen. The service continues with prayers of intercession. Let us pray. On this first Sunday in Lent, let us pray boldly for all in need, responding to each petition with the words echoing today's psalm, "In you we put our trust." Relying on you, O God of our salvation, we pray for the church throughout the world, that strengthened by the promises of baptism, we discern your way of truth and justice and reject the attractive lures of evil. Sustain all who are beset with temptations or hardship. Receive our prayers, O righteous God. In you
we put our trust.
You have made a covenant of mercy with every living creature. Protect all the earth from destruction, especially our neighbors in Texas. Receive our prayers, O creative God. In you we put our trust. Distressed by injustice and violence, we pray for leaders who govern in our nation and around the world, that they will strive for equality and concord in all things. Visit the people of Myanmar and Sudan and stop the might of tyrants the world over. Receive our prayers, O sovereign God. In you we put our trust. Alert to the difficulties of wintertime, we pray for all who are without heat, for all those without shelter, for refugees awaiting assistance, and for all whose employment requires them to endure brutal weather. Surround them with a community of concern and compassion. Receive our prayers, O warm-hearted God. In you we put our trust. Pained by the suffering of others, we pray for all who are sick, especially those we name here before you. Jatina, Monica, Lonnie and Robin, Chrisida, Pat, Alfred, and family, Russell, Reggie and Linda Taylor, Craig and Laura Jones and family, Daphne, Beverly, Barbara, Andrew and Everton, Pastor Cara, Pastor Louisa, Pastor Brenda, Medlin, Dorrit, Deirdre and Selwyn, Pastor Katrina, Foster and family, Zanetha and Clement, Bernice, Bruce and Rita, Paul, John, Nora, Cecil, Wade, Christina, Emmy, Francina, Thelma, Ernestine and Glenwood, and Francis. We pray for all who have contracted COVID-19, for those who are bowed down by trials of any kind, for those who face natural disasters, for those whose suffering is known only to you. Comfort those who feel desolate. Give health and wholeness to all who suffer. Receive our prayers, O benevolent God. In you, we put our trust. Praying also for ourselves, we seek your spirit to accompany us through each wilderness that we must endure. Hear now the desires of our hearts. Receive our prayers, O tender and mighty God. In you we put our trust. We praise you for the faithful of time past, especially all the martyrs who died in their witness to you. Give us the faith that at the end, your rainbow will bring endless beauty to all things. Receive our prayers, O splendid God. In you we put our trust. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray together on mute as we raise our phones and our checks towards the heavens, whatever method that you give your offerings or your tithe. Let's pray together on mute as we pray. Faithful God, you walk beside us in desert places. And you meet us in our hunger with bread from heaven. Receive these gifts that we offer back to you in gratitude for all that we have been given. Accompany us in this meal, O God, that we may pass over from death to life with Jesus, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also
with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them
to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for the Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which our Lord was to be betrayed, he took bread, gave thanks for it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Each time you eat of this bread, do this in remembrance of me." And then, as was the custom after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks for it, and gave it to each one present, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you drink from this cup, do this in remembrance of me." With this bread and with this cup, we remember the Lord's Passover from death into life, and we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Come, Holy Spirit. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for this world. Breathe into us new life. Send us forth burning with justice, peace, and love. Come, Holy Spirit. With your beloved gathered here and your holy ones across all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with the sun and the moon and the stars, we praise you, O God. Blessed Holy Trinity, one God, now and forever. And God's people said, Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, beloved, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. My brothers and sisters, beloved of God, the body of Christ, broken for you. The blood of Christ, shed for you. Beloved of God, may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you all and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Let us pray. God of steadfast love, at this table, you gather your people into one body for the sake of the world. Send us in the power of your Spirit that our lives bear witness to the love that has made us new in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen. We have been nourished by word and song. God blesses us and sends us in mission to the world. Receive the charge, the blessing, and the dismissal. Beloved people of God, go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, and help the suffering. Honor all people. And love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Receive the blessing. You, beloved, are what God made you to be, created in Christ Jesus for good works, chosen as holy and beloved, chosen to serve your neighbor. God bless you, that you may be a blessing to others. In the name of the Holy and Life-Giving Trinity, amen.
Go in peace, share the good news. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
Everything's gonna be alright. Be alright. Be alright. Be alright. Jesus already told me everything's gonna be alright. Oh, Jesus already told me everything's gonna be alright. My Jesus already told me everything's gonna be alright. Be alright, be alright, be alright. The Holy Ghost has confirmed it. Everything's gonna be alright. Oh, the Holy Ghost has confirmed it. Everything's gonna be alright. Holy Ghost has confirmed it. Everything's gonna be alright. Be alright. Be alright. Be alright. Oh, I got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Oh, I got a feeling everything's gonna be alright. Everything's gonna be alright. Be alright. Be alright. Be alright.
Thank you, Clive.
Beautiful. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you so much, Clive. Thank you, Good Shepherd family, for being here this morning. As always, it is my hope that something said or sung here today, or just the spirit that abounds among us,
amen,
that it has lifted you and given you sustenance for your journey.
Yes.
Hopefully I'll see many of you, if not all of you, on Wednesday evening for our Lenten study. Thanks so much for being here this morning.
Thank you, Pastor.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you, Pastor.
Amen.
Thank you, Pastor.
Amen.
Amen.
You're looking good.
Good morning, family. Oh, Robin says, good morning.
Hey, Tina.
Hey, good morning, folks.
Good morning, Tina. How are you?
Doing much better today. My first day up out of bed.
Good to see you.
Very good.
Good to see you all. Thank you, Pastor.
Hi, Tina.
Thank you very much.
Glad you're feeling better.
Hi, Jenny.
I hear Jenny. I see the Shepherd family, Miss Clendenin.
Yes.
Everyone, Pastor, good morning.
Hi, Mom and Pop Shepherd.
Hi, Grandma.
Hey, Jenny.
Good morning, Mother Shepherd and Pop Shepherd.
All right, here you go.
Praise God.
Good morning, Grandma.
Good morning, Grandma.
Good morning, Shepherd family from Robin. Good morning.
Good morning, Robin.
Good morning, Robin.
Hope everyone is doing well.
Reggie.
God bless.
Good morning, Grandpa.
Good morning, Reggie.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning,
good morning, good morning, Tom. Tom, you read very nicely this morning.
Thank you for your history lesson, Joan.
Oh, very nice. Very interesting. Yes.
Yeah, very. Forgot about Fred, Reverend Fred.
Yeah, he is often forgotten about when we talk about the civil rights movement, but, he was truly one of the champions out there on the front line.
Yes.
I remember seeing him in St. Louis.
Wow.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Some of the Buffalo Soldiers.
Yes.
Beautiful.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Pastor, from Andrea from Montana.
Hi, Andrea. Thanks for being with us today.
Andrea.
Thank you.
Yes.
Have a blessed week.
You too.
Everybody do the same.
All right, everyone. Have a good week. We'll see you Wednesday.
Yeah.
All right.
Have a good day.
Everybody be safe.
Good morning, Mother Clendenin. Good to see you.
Thank you very much.
Happy Christmas,
Clendenin.
Okay, I'm going to go back and lay down. Everyone, have a good day and a good week.
All right, take care, Shatina.
Thank you so much. Okay, now, bye bye.
Good to see you, Glenn.
Thank you, Shepherd. Love you.
Thank you.
The
Shepherd.
Okay.
It's so good to see both of your faces this morning, Mom and Pop Shepherd.
Yes. Absolutely. Oh, yes. Look at what you got this beard grow.
Okay. Good morning. Enjoyed it.
Thank you, Helen. Have a good week.
Yes, you too. Take care.
All right. Pastor, be well. Thank you for the beautiful message.
Yeah, it was
amen. Good. Praise God. Yeah. It's most of that is not me. God and the Holy Spirit does what they do. I'm just the vessel.
I've got the feeling.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
But the vessel is working.
All right,
amen. So, thank you so much, Mother Clinton.
Thank you, Clive.
You're welcome. Okay. Everyone have a blessed week. Stay safe.
And you too.
Thank you and everyone.
Thank you.
Amen. Everybody be safe. Be warm.
Yes. Be safe. Stay warm.
Yes.
We will gather again, God willing.
Okay.
That's right.
Okay, sounds good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Not leaving coffee.